now declare this meeting open. Recordings may now commence. Are there any declarations of interest by individual members in relation to any item on the agenda? I'm not aware of any additional items of business which I've determined should be considered as matters of urgency, and for items of business which may require the exclusion of the press and public during consideration thereof because of the possibility of disclosing of exempt information. So we move on now to minutes of our previous meeting on pages 5 to 8. Go through them for matters of accuracy. Page 1, 2, 3, 4. Are members happy that I sign these? We've only one item of business on our agenda this afternoon, and that is the corporate risk register update, April to June. Anyone need to speak?
I will indeed, thanks, Chair. Thanks to note the purpose of this report is to inform members of the current risks contained within the corporate risk register, status of the risks, and associated control measures that should be put in place to mitigate those risks. And the report will include reference to any new risks introduced or any of the risks which are no longer applicable and can be removed. And the recommendation of the report is that members approve the report and the updated corporate risk register. As members will know, it's good practice to regularly review internal and external risks to the ongoing delivery of the service by the authority, and it's with this end that this corporate risk register has been produced. So I have a particular reference to paragraph 7, which says, members are asked to note the risk control measures implemented for the following risks. Risk 1.1, insufficient staff to maintain current levels of operational planning, training and management of intelligence. And just to note that, that is an ongoing issue for the authority, and as a result of the recent recruit course, we are hoping that we will have 16 new firefighters leaving the service and into an operational role come sometime in October. In relation to paragraph 9, which is risk 1.3, insufficient firefighters to maintain current levels of response and the number of firefighters, and again to bring members to attention, our whole time retained working has been introduced at units in Willow and St Helens, meaning the provision of additional retained appliances will offset the risk posed by the number of appliances not readily available, and that's an ongoing issue for the authority, and the authority will recall that we are seeking to introduce more whole-time retained appliances to give us more resilience during large or protracted incidents, and that is an ongoing piece of work we are undertaking with the representative bodies. Risk 4.6 is increased flood risk and risk for extreme weather. And again, to highlight to members that all frontline crew are trained and equipped to respond to storm water rescue, and the urban search and rescue team are all swift water trained and rescue boat operators. And finally, in regards to the new and additional risks and control measures, risk 6.6, restrictions on storing sensitive information on a Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority network. Services is in the process of processing the government security classifications and will include consideration of any restrictions my holding mark information on the network at that juncture as part of an ongoing piece of work around corporate governance. So there are no equality and diversity implications, there's no staff implications associated with this. The actual corporate risk register is contained within appendices A. And I'm happy to take any questions, Chair, in regards to the report or the attached risk register.
Chair, can I ask a question? It's on page 10, item 8. And it's in relationship to the where we've actually sent our some of our operatives over the water to Cheshire to do it, and for obvious reasons, it's going to be a costly exercise, and it will have an impact on the budget going outside of our remit for the budget itself. You know, we're controlling the budget for it in house. So I think it adds extra risk to what we're saying in regard to this now. Could we have ask the future for the chief officer to give us a report in regard to this particular incident, the cost and what the manpower implications are for it? If this kind of thing happened elsewhere, given the reductions that we've had in recent times, how would we cope if it happened twice in the 1 week? How would we be able to manage? Thanks, Chair.
Happy to respond to that first instance, but we'll know the fact that the request that Chief Officer to provide the report and our specific details. What we have in place is 13-16 arrangements which allow us to deploy our resources across border. We also have national arrangements through national resilience set up to deploy our crews, particularly our urban search and rescue crews, across the whole of the UK, and that even extends into international deployments. But as a result of that, that means 10 individuals are mobilised for a protracted period of time to deal with an incident, and we have to subsequently replace those individuals. And there are schemes available within the Fire and Rescue Service, Bell scheme as an example, where Fire and Rescue Service can seek recompense for large scale major incidents. Now, whether that's appropriate or applicable under these circumstances, the report will be more akin to mobilisation under 1360 arrangements, where we would seek recompense from that particular Fire and Rescue Service if we felt that to be appropriate. And certainly, you know, when we are mobilising some of our crews into places like Cheshire, Lancashire, Manchester, equally on occasion they will mobilise their crews in support of cover moves to cover our requirements, particularly important as we're moving forward, given the fact that reducing the number of fire stations and reducing the number of fire engines and the fact of firefighters. So those interrelationships and then interdependencies become more and more pertinent as we move forward. And you know, one breath you wouldn't necessarily want to charge a neighbouring fire service, you know, to be recharged by them for some action subsequently. But it is a draw on the service of that, there's no doubt about its capabilities. But to reassure members, when we deploy our urban search and rescue team, you know, we are recalling in a number of individuals who will continue to staff up that provision again for us in Merseyside, but also for the region and nationally. And those teams extend across the UK, so they're not just singling Fire and Rescue Service, Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service specific. So there are arrangements in place for dealing with such incidents. However, you know, just as testimony against the kind of the professionalism of the staff in Merseyside that have been deployed to support our Cheshire colleagues in what is a very challenging set of circumstances. But I'm happy and content as the case to bring back a report following the conclusion of that instance to reassure you that the safeguards are in place to protect the individuals that have been mobilised, but also understand the financial implications to the authority.
That's one of the chairman.
Can I just ask a question on that as well? I mean, I know that we've been keen, and I know members have been keen for the incident in Cheshire to hopefully have the attendance of either the Fire Minister or somebody from the DCLG. I don't think the Fire Minister's been, but I think Peter Holland, the Fire Service Advisor to DCLG, was down there yesterday. what sort of mechanisms will be in place for what obviously Peter Holland witnesses, and how will that be reported in? Have you any idea to DCLG? So in an attempt really to again make our case that, you know, when these incidents do happen, not only ourselves but clearly other fire and rescue services are stretched. Is there any way we can get any feedback from what Peter Holland may have actually taken away from that yesterday?
Absolutely,
and
again, we can make that request to the fire and rescue services advisor, so Mr. Peter Holland. Additionally, you've had our chief, who's gone out there this morning with the chief of Hertfordshire, who has national responsibility for operations, and obviously, you know, Dan's role is more akin to, you know, specific rescue and rescue techniques related to search and rescue elements of the functions. So they are both on site at this moment in time to support, again, you know, our Cheshire colleagues and chief officers, Cheshire Paul Hancock. But as Peter Holland has been out, he has a mechanism for reporting back into government in that regard. However, we will establish whether that has actually, you know, been followed through and in what way he's replied back the information on the scene and the complexity and nature of the incident. Because, you know, like anything else, it's important that that is seen for what it's worth about this. Really challenging taxing environment in which firefighters are operating, trying to protect the public and save lives. And, you know, we were hopeful that the fire minister would attend, unfortunately, for whatever reason, we wanted to attend. And Peter Holland has accepted it. But I'm sure that he will relay that information back to the fire minister and government. But we will ask for a response, so we can provide that response at a later date. You know, probably part of the law, the report that we'll bring back to specific.
No further questions or comments. Do we move it? We approve the update of corporate discipline. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of our business. I think we should have recorded apologies from Kieran Timmons. So, in that case, thank you for your attendance, and the meeting is closed.